due to these interesting conditions, we maintain our virtual seminars from IAP. So Polychronis Papaderos is our guest, so I am very pleased to introduce you. Welcome, Polis. How are you? You hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me now?
No, I think it's better. Everybody hear you? Yeah, Sandrine? Okay.
I hope that now it's better.
So a brief introduction to so that you know who is Polis Papaderos. He studied at the University of Göttingen, and from there he carried on a thesis under the supervision of Hans Loos. Then it was taken over by Klaus Fricke, and the subject of the topic of the thesis was blue compact galaxies. And then he became assistant professor at Göttingen. Further, he came to Meudon Observatory, where we met, with many colleagues there. And he, in particular, he started to work with, collaborate with Trinix Tran on this blue compact galaxy subject. We met at IAP many times, and I remember that we discussed blue structures on filaments around 1CK18, which is the prototype of this kind of field. And I think probably, well, certainly, yes, Polis will speak about this again. And later on, he went to Andalusia, working with Pepe Vilches in 2014, I think. But before that, he joined Porto. He was Porto University. And he was a leader of galaxy cosmology and evolution of the universe, this group. And then, of course, he has been traveling everywhere in the world. Maybe the best chance to meet him would be to go to Santa Cruz, Uppsala, or Vienna, or Stockholm, Max Planck at Bonn. The last time we met, Polis was in Crete, so that you co-organized a very interesting meeting on Lyman alpha emission, Lyman alpha galaxies. And today, you will speak about one of our very favored subjects, which is extremely metal poor blue compact galaxies as local analogs of proto galaxies. So thank you, Polis.
Thank you, Daniel, for a nice introduction. It is a special pleasure and honor for me to be here virtually with you. Daniel, when I was a student and later I was reading every single word of your papers. I remember those times. And now I do not know whether I can really have to report something new. Probably you know everything. But anyway, I will try to give a summary of our current knowledge on extremely metal poor star-forming galaxies, blue compact galaxies. I will not go too much into detail, but merely focus on some questions that I think that are relevant and worth exploring in the future. First, let me tell you a few words about the Institute for of Astrophysics and Space Science in Portugal. It has was created in 2014 by merging the two most prominent research units in astrophysics in Portugal, Porto and Lisbon. We're about 100 researchers and students. As you mentioned, Daniel, I'm serving there as leader of the team. I have to thank many colleagues for inspiring discussions, for ideas, both outside of IA and within the team. I cannot mention all of them, but what I'm telling today is not the result of my own research, but also the result of the interaction with many colleagues and students. So a few words about the motivation behind the study of extremely metal poor star-forming galaxies. I will not repeat known things. We know, or there's a general consensus, that the first sources that have reionized the universe about 300 to 500 million years after the Big Bang, as we have been small proto-galactic units, dwarf galaxies with very high specific star formation rate. There have been, of course, the first AGN there in the epoch of ionization as well, but the consensus is that the prime source of the cosmic ionization have been these proto-dwarf galaxies, extremely metal-poor or metal-free galaxies undergoing strong star-forming activity. And the question is how we can get insights into the early evolution of these systems and the Lyman continuum escape fraction of them. Of course, it is not possible to directly detect the Lyman continuum at the epoch of ionization because the universe is opaque, and even with new facilities like the James Webb Space Telescope and the ELT, it will not be possible to have detailed studies of these proto-galaxies. We need local analogs, the best local analogs of those first galaxies that will enable us spatially resolved investigations of the starburst phenomenon in those phases, the feedback between young stars, eventually pop 3 stars, and the surrounding gas and the escape of Lyman continuum radiation. Well, in the local universe, we have metal-poor galaxies, but these galaxies span a wide range in star formation rate, specific star formation rate, mean star formation surface density, and surface brightness. On the one side, we have low surface brightness metal-poor galaxies. There's an interesting chapter in itself, a wide chapter. We have a dwarf spheroidal, some of them contain gas, some also show faint nebular emission, they are metal poor. And it's interesting also to study these galaxies because they have apparently experienced a retarded evolution, they are slowly cooking dark galaxies. But I will not talk about these systems because they simply sustain very low level of star-forming activity, if any at all. I will talk about high surface brightness, high specific star formation rate, metal poor galaxies, as the best analogs of proto-galaxies at higher redshifts. We have basically three candidates, three classes in the literature. Those that we call blue compact dwarf galaxies. These are gas-rich systems with a high compactness and star formation activity. Typical masses of a few hundred million solar masses and a typical gas phase metallicity, so 12 oxygen over hydrogen of about 8.1, a few times lower than the solar value. At higher redshifts, different samples have been compiled, including the so-called luminous blue compact galaxies, compact narrow emission line galaxies, and the green piece in more recent times. They are the most, the more massive counterparts, I would say, of local BCDs, blue compact dwarf galaxies. And finally, the most metal poor emission line starburst galaxies are the extremely interesting, I would say, xBCDs with the lowest stellar masses and a gas phase metallicity ranging between 7 and 7.6 approximately. And this is would be the topic of my talk. On the luminosity metallicity relation, these are determinations based on the 4363 line. You see basically that the luminous blue compact galaxies and Greenpeace are populating the high luminosity regime at absolute magnitudes of about minus 20. They have subsolar metallicity, but not extremely low metallicity so far. And BCDs and xBCDs occupy the lower part of the diagram with absolute magnitudes between minus 10 and minus 18, and gas phase metallicities that reach up to 7. And at the time when Daniel was writing with Jeroen Estlin his review in 2000 to metal poor galaxies, we knew about 15 of these extremely metal poor systems. In the meantime, due to intensive work with STSS, many more, about 70 more xBCDs were discovered. In the higher redshift universe, we know a few metal poor galaxies as well. Some of them were discovered by Kakatsu, Kyulei, and Hakim, but there are not many. So we have basically now a local sample of about 70, 80 xBCDs that we can statistically analyze in the context of their structural properties, chemical patterns, and other properties. I will discuss the first part of my talk, the blue compact dwarf galaxies in general. So the class of PCDs in the range of subsolar metallicity between 1/5 and 1/10 of the solar value. Then continue with extremely metal poor PCDs, xBCDs. Another thing that I would like to discuss is the importance of nebular emission in studies of these galaxies. I will emphasize that a consideration of the nebular continuum emission is important for a proper determination of the physical and evolutionary properties of these systems. And finally, I will discuss challenges that we are facing when we are applying self-consistent spectral synthesis models to integral field spectroscopy data for these galaxies. I will specifically discuss the problem of the spatial decoupling between stellar and nebular emission and what would be the consequences when we apply spectral fitting tools in systems showing this decoupling. So a few words about blue compact galaxies. As Daniel has pointed out years ago, morphologically they form a mixed pack of systems. We see all kinds of morphologies from regular, elliptical, circular galaxies all the way to distorted irregular galaxies. Typical masses of about 10 to 8 to 10 to 9 solar masses, typical dimensions of 1 kiloparsec in diameter. It is important to know that, to remember that BCDs and xBCDs are not, most of them are not strongly interacting, but many of them were found in loose pairs groups of galaxies. By Postlink 95, and very recently this week, there was a nice article by Travis and Mamont, one and others, that have documented this point, that many of these metal poor galaxies are residing in loose galaxy groups. It is important to remember that the majority of PCDs falls in the morphological class of IE and NE systems, as defined by Lozentuan in 85. The first letter stands for the morphology of the high surface brightness region, and the second for the low surface brightness host galaxy. So in 90% of local PCDs, we see a circular or elliptical evolved stellar host. And in about 70% of those systems, star-forming activity is occurring in several star-forming regions spread in the inner part over the inner part of the galaxy, whereas in about 20%, star formation is confined to the inner part. Whereas we have also a small fraction of cometary galaxies where star-forming activity is confined to the tip of an elongated stellar host. And finally, a very small fraction of galaxies defined as I0 without any evident underlying low surface brightness host. These are the Sillet-Sanjot objects. I would like to mention that structural properties of PCDs are important for different reasons. One of those is that we want to extract the structural properties of the LSP host, which define basically the form of the gravitational potential formed by the older, higher mass light ratio stars, and to explore whether the form of the gravitational potential is partly responsible for the starburst cycle in these systems. However, contrary to, say, elliptical galaxies, BCDs are difficult objects to study photometrically. They are the superposition of different stellar populations with vastly different mass-light ratios, and one needs to decompose the old host from the young stellar clusters. And this one example, you see here in the BCD Magellan 178 that the inner part of the elliptical host galaxy contains a number of young stellar clusters spread over several hundred parsecs and a few very luminous sources. On the right-hand side, you see the surface brightness profiles of the galaxy in the B and R band, and in the lower panel, the radial color profiles of the galaxy computed by subtraction of the R profile from the B band profile. There is a correspondence between morphology and surface photometry profiles. In the low surface brightness regime, we see an exponential decrease, which is characteristic of the old host galaxy. We know also that dwarf ellipticals and dwarf irregulars show exponential profiles. Other dwarf galaxies at intermediate intensities, there is a bump. This is basically the cumulative luminosity output from all these star-forming regions in the central part of the galaxy. And finally, in the inner part, the central peak corresponds to the brightest star-forming cluster. The color profile in the lower panel reveals a kind of constancy in the colors of the LSP host, which is indicative of an old stellar population formed at least 10 giga-years ago. And in the inner parts, profiles show a kind of linear increase of colors, representing or as a result of the decreasing line of sight contribution of young stars to the observed luminosity. Of course, dealing with these profiles requires a decomposition into Gaussian surface and exponential profiles components, and this is a quite complicated task. Now, the H1 properties, we know that BCDs are very gas-rich with a typical H1 to optical extent of 3 to 10. H1 and helium can dominate the dynamical mass, the baryonic mass of these galaxies, provide up to 90% of the total mass. Most of these galaxies show regular rotation. Perhaps they're not rotationally supported, but they show rotation. We know some cases also with peculiar H1 distributions and kinematics, like in Tutsbiki 40. This is a spectrum, an optical spectrum of a low-metallicity BCD. It shows a steeply increasing continuum towards the blue, indicative of substantial population of massive OB stars. It is interesting to note that especially for xBCDs, for very metal-poor BCDs, the detection a few years ago of high excitation lines like neon 5, iron 5, and also a strong helium emission, helium 2 emission, with a relative intensity of up to 5% with respect to H beta, is an interesting observational constraint to current stellar evolution models. Most of the ideas that are now proposed for the excitation of these lines are linked to perhaps X-ray binaries, shocks, binary massive stars, and so on. In any case, a comparison between the observed high excitation lines indicating a harder nascent field in these systems. It's an interesting observational constraint to existing stellar models. Now, coming to the morphology of stratospheric activity in BCDs, I would like to show you a couple of examples. Here you see some results on Chennai 210, one famous BCD, the first Wolf-Rayet galaxy, by the way. In the lower parts, you see a ground-based image, and in the three further panels, color composites produced by using HST data. In blue and green, you see stellar emission, and in red, the H-alpha. You see that within the central region of about 1 kiloparsec, stratospheric activity is spread over several young stellar classes. In the eastern part, low-mass young stellar classes formed almost coevally. In the inner, in the western part of the galaxy, the surface brightness increases dramatically, and zooming in the center, one realized the existence of the so-called superstar clusters, so highly compact, massive young stellar clusters, masses of up to 10 to 5 solar masses, and densities reaching 10 to 4 solar masses per cubic parsec. These are extreme manifestations of the starburst phenomenon, discovered first, I believe, in Chennai 210 by Conti in 94, and studied in the meantime by many other galaxies. Important is to remember that the energetic output from these young superstar clusters is enormous. It is sufficient for unbounding the cold molecular gas phase of these galaxies and initiating a large-scale outflow, a galactic wind. Here you see in the left panel model predictions by Lederer of the so-called mechanical luminosity as a function of time for a continuous star formation episode with one solar mass per year. In the first 3 to 4 million years, radiation-driven stellar winds are dominating the mechanical luminosity budget, whereas later on supernova take over. The result of this is a large-scale acceleration and thermalization of the gas, as shown nicely here in the H-alpha-gradient width map of the galaxy, showing a biconical outflow of gas with an expansion velocity of about 200 kilometers per second away from the star-forming component. What powers this expansion? We know it is hot X-ray emitting plasma. You see here a superposition of the H-alpha map with X-ray contours from ROSET. Metal-rich plasma that eventually escapes into the galactic halo or beyond. And we know a few cases of galactic winds, like in NGC 1569, where in the inner part, a number of superstar clusters and other young clusters have basically evacuated the cold gas. We see H alpha in the rim outside of the galaxy, or in the periphery of the galaxy. In the right panel, you see with the contours the H1 neutral gas distribution, with red the H-alpha emission, and in green the X-ray, the soft X-ray emission. And it is obvious that the hot plasma has broken through the cold ambient gas and is expanding into the galactic halo. Whether it is a blowout or blow away, it's a long-standing question discussed theoretically, would not know. But what is for sure is that the energetic output from a starburst in a blue compact galaxy is more than sufficient for initiating an outflow of hot metal-rich gas into the halo, at least. There are different arguments discussed about the chronology of a starburst. The idea is that starburst activity is cyclic. It occurs over a timescale of 1 giga year. Gas collapses, forms stars, then thermalization of gas due to these young stars and supernova leads to depletion, removal of the cold gas supply, termination of star-forming activity. The galaxy returns into a quiescent phase, and after a phase of replenishment of cold gas and cooling, we have the next starburst episode. So the star formation history of those systems is assumed to be following this kind of distribution. There are many questions that I would not have time to discuss. We would like to know, for instance, what is the origin of starburst activity in these systems? Are weak interactions, for instance, or it's kind of self-gravitating gas that leads to the starburst, to the ignition of a starburst event? We would like to know more about the structure and kinematics of the underlying host galaxy, so basically the gravitational potential of the old stars. There are some surprises here. There is evidence that a fraction of BCDs shows a central flattening in the exponential central surface brightness profile of the host galaxy. These are infrared data by Nusky et al. And the central flattening implies basically a depletion, a central luminosity minimum in the stellar mass density, which is an interesting thing and could eventually imply or suggest adiabatic expansion of the stellar component due to starburst-driven removal of gas. There are other enigmas as well. We see BCDs, the formation of several hundreds of young stellar clusters on spatial scales of hundreds of parsecs, coeval star formation over these spatial scales. And the question is, what is the synchronization mechanism for this star formation? And of course, the 3D evolution of the gas in this galaxy's starburst activity and the production, the escape of Lyman alpha and continuum radiation are key topics explored. There are, thanks to MUSE, especially to MUSE, interesting data now being analyzed in several recent papers. Studies of the metallicity of PCDs, kinematics, excitation properties that would actually justify a whole dedicated seminar, but we do not have time for a detailed discussion. But there is a lot of work now coming. I will move to the second and main part of this webinar. I will discuss now the properties of extremely matter-poor BCDs. So more than 95% of all BCDs show this old circular or elliptical host galaxy. This is not the case for the most metal-poor BCDs known. These are young galaxy candidates in the nearby universe and probably the best local analogs of proto-galaxies at the epoch of ionization. The metallicity spans between 6.9 and 7.6 approximately, and it's important to note that even deep optical and infrared imaging, under consideration of the effect of nebular emission that I will discuss next, shows that these systems do not contain a dominant all stellar population. In fact, more than 50% of the present stellar mass has likely formed over the past 1 to 3 giga years. So these galaxies are young in the sense of having experienced the dominant phase of their assembly history at the late cosmic epoch. And they show, as apparent from the figure, an irregular morphology. Just a comparison between the old elliptical host of normal higher metallicity BCDs and the morphology of xBCDs shown in this collage. You see that all kind of regular morphologies between a kind of triangle distribution here and many cometary galaxies. So galaxies where astrophobic activity is occurring at the tip of an elongated host. This host, in many cases, was found to show age gradients, so an increasing age as we move away from the current star-forming region, which is an indication of star formation propagation. I would like to show you one example. This is the xBCD pair SPS of the 5052 discovered by Isotov in 1990. You see here an H1 VLA map of the system with the two galaxies, both close to the H1 surface density maximum of a massive cloud with a mass of 10 to 9 solar masses. Here again, images of the two galaxies. And in the left lower panel, you see a contour map produced from HST data with the six superstar clusters powering the mission of SPS 035 East indicated. You also see an extended supercell about 1.5 kiloparsec away from the superstar clusters. What we have done a long time ago was to use a kind of unsharp masking technique, get rid of the higher surface brightness stellar component, and look for the distribution of several star clusters in the galaxy. What color studies and age studies of these stellar clusters found through unsharp masking has revealed was an age trend. From older ages in the northwestern direction to young ages to the at the position of the superstar clusters. And a comparison with evolution of this model shows that this age distribution is consistent with the propagation star formation process with a mean velocity of about 20 kilometers per second. So on the order of the sound speed in the warm gas. So this galaxy is forming in a propagating manner. Yeah. And you can expect that in this process, after a few hundred million years, one would expect to find a cometary galaxy, a galaxy with a tail of all the stars formed previously and a bright head with the ongoing star forming activity. Now, what is also interesting is what recent work with MUSE, with the MUSE IFU has shown. We have found long extensions, long tails of H-alpha emissions, emission protruding up to 15 kiloparsec away from the superstar clusters in this galaxy. And interpret this evidence as due to leakage of Lyman continuum radiation from SSCs through pre-existing channels in the cold gas that have been carved in the propagation process. So star formation has started in the northwestern part of the galaxy, propagated to the southeast, and leaving behind hot rarefied gas. And this gas allows Lyman continuum radiation from the SSCs, the superstar clusters, to escape in the northeastern direction, so the direction of through which the propagation process has continued. Now the thing, what is important is that this kind of galaxy formation through propagation implies basically an anisotropic escape of Lyman continuum radiation. And this is important to eventually take into account into models and could eventually lead to an upward revision of estimates of the escape fraction of Lyman continuum photons at high redshifts. In any case, you know that models exploring the Lyman continuum escape process consider a spheric symmetric geometry. If it is ionization bound or density bound, all these models are spheric symmetric. And what we propose in this paper is that the formation of a xBCD of a young galaxy can lead to a kind of a preferential escape of Lyman continuum radiation, a high directional escape that should be taken into account. Interesting is also to note that there are at higher redshifts found about 7% of this kind of cometary or chain galaxies. It is an interesting topic to explore how morphology is connected with evolutionary status and metallicity. And by the way, it might be also interesting to study in the context of weak lensing studies by Euclid how these cometary galaxies at high redshifts could eventually impact the weak lensing signal. There are, as I mentioned already, a substantial number of 7 to 10% of these galaxies are chain or cometary galaxies. In any case, we see from local BCDs and xBCDs a connection between evolutionary status, morphology, and nebular metallicity. And it is interesting to further explore this connection and also quantify the change in the morphology of a galaxy from cometary irregular galaxies to elliptical galaxies in connection with nebular metallicity and other properties. And so far, most quantitative morphology indicators are based on the patch to disk ratio, Sasse index, the CAS system, the Gini coefficient. But actually, we need to extend this kind of quantitative morphology indicators. Think about new indicators that could describe the degree of asymmetry in a kind of cometary galaxy, and also look in more detail what these cometary galaxies at higher redshift, how their properties are and their evolutionary history. The third part of my talk that I will pass quickly is dedicated to the importance of nebular emission. We know that BCDs and xBCDs show a strong line emission exceeding in many cases 1,000 angstrom in equivalent width. This was already studied by Solsa in 1989, and also recent work by, for instance, Hakim shows that nebular line emission can contribute more than 50% of the total optical rest frame luminosity of intermediate redshift starburst galaxies. Let's take a look at the model predictions for the nebular emission. Old work done by Krüger et al. In Göttingen. Daniel knows this paper because he was a referee, right, Daniel? And what you see here in the left part is as a function of wavelength, the contribution of continuum and line nebular emission to the total luminosity observed in different bands from U all the way to K and L. It is important to note that continuum emission is not so important in the optical spectral range, but it decreases in the infrared, whereas the optical, it is the main contaminant is our nebular emission lines, oxygen 3, edge alpha. In the right panel, you see as a function of wavelength, the total luminosity contribution by nebular emission, continuum and lines for three models invoking three different burst parameters. The burst parameter is defined as the mass ratio of young stars to all stars ever formed. And what is important to note is that in strong starburst, producing up to 10% of the total stellar mass in a single episode, the nebular emission, continuum emission, is very important in the infrared, in the K band. It can exceed 50%. And this is something to remember, to keep in mind, that the K band luminosity is a good tracer of the stellar mass of galaxies for normal galaxies, not for starburst galaxies. For starburst galaxies, K-band emission can primarily originate from nebular continuum emission. And this is also important to remember that the spectral slope of ionizing stellar stars differs from the flat spectral slope of nebular continuum. In the right panel, you see the first, spectral decomposition of a starburst galaxy into stellar emission gas, and here's the total that was years ago in SPS 035. And what is important to note is that the stellar continuum is blue, whereas the nebular continuum is relatively flat, which means that as we go from blue to red wavelengths, the relative contribution of the nebular continuum increases. And this point was nicely shown some years later by Yuri Zotov in the study of a green B galaxy. Again, you see the same experiment, spectral decomposition of the galaxy into stars and gas. And in the right panel, you see the relative contribution of nebular continuum to the observed continuum. It increases by a factor of 2 from the blue to the red to the I band. In the I band, the nebular continuum contributes almost 50% of the emission, whereas in the blue, only about 20%. So the ionizing stellar component is so steep, SED, steep spectrum, whereas the resulting nebular emission is flatter. And that's why the general spectrum of the combined spectrum of a galaxy is shows a kind of intermediate slope. And this has in turn several implications when we apply spectral modeling techniques to infer physical and evolutionary properties of these galaxies, like for instance, total stellar mass and mass-weighted stellar age. If the nebular continuum emission is neglected, as in most cases was done in popular synthesis models like Starlight or StackMap, then the main effect would be a systematic overestimation of the stellar mass and age of a galaxy. As nicely pointed out by Isotov et al., for a purely stellar model, in order to account for the red spectral continuum, it has no other choice than to invoke a much too high mass to light ratio stellar component to systematically overestimate the stellar mass of the galaxy, correspondingly to underestimate then the specific star formation rate. And the difference, the dramatic importance of nebular continuum emission in spectral modeling studies of starburst galaxies is shown by a comparison of a purely stellar population synthesis code like Starlight with FADO. This is a self-consistent spectral code that we have developed in Porto that includes both nebular and stellar emission. Here you see as a function of time the difference between the true and the determined stellar mass of a galaxy. The input to these models are synthetic spectra for an instantaneous and continuous star formation episode that were then fit by both Starlight and FADO, and we compared the results. You see that for an instantaneous starburst, in the first 10 million years, a purely stellar code can overestimate the stellar mass by more than one order of magnitude. This is the phase where strong nebular emission is present. And in the case of a continuous star formation model, this mass overestimate can extend up to several giga years, even after 1 giga year, fitting a realistic galaxy spectrum with a continuous star forming activity with a purely stellar code can lead to an overestimation of the stellar mass by a factor of 2 or so. And the same applies to mass-weighted stellar ages. A purely stellar code applied to a starburst galaxy can overestimate the true stellar age by several giga-years. Now, I will keep this very short. I would like to mention that although mostly over the past years, purely stellar codes were used, like Starlight, Stegma, Pulis, and so on. In the recent past, we have important developments in this field. We have a number of new codes proposed, and in the last few years, population synthesis codes, so inverse codes, taking as input the observed spectrum and giving as output the star formation and chemical enrichment history. I would like to mention Beagle, Bagpipes, Gigal, Prospector, and also our code FADO that we developed at the IA. This is a fit of a starburst galaxy of a blue compact with FADO, and you see here that we can nicely reproduce the pass and jump as due to superposition of a stellar continuum is shown in gray and the nebular emission in red. And important is also to remember that this self-consistency between stellar and nebular emission can strongly alleviate the notorious age, metallicity, extinction, degeneracy, plugging all previous population synthesis codes. And to finish this webinar, I know that I'm a bit late. I would like to discuss another problem connected with nebular emission. And I believe it's very relevant to the study of xBCDs and BCDs with spatially resolved data. I would like to talk about the spatial decoupling between nebular emission and ionizing stellar backgrounds, both on subgalactic and galactic scales. Tuan, Isotov, and Lipovetsky have first studied SPSO35 with HST97, and they found a kind of blue rim in V minus I color maps. And already by that time, they interpret these very blue colors as due to effect of nebular emission. And the reason was that the V minus I color that they have determined was about minus 0.7, so far too blue to be explained by massive OB stars that can reach values of not lower than minus 0.3 in V minus I. So they said it is because the strong contamination of the V-band emission by the oxygen 3 line, why the colors of this galaxy are getting so blue in this rim. 1 year later, we have studied this spatial distribution of young ionizing clusters and the color morphology of the galaxy in further detail. Here you see with contours the isochromes, so regions with equal color, superimposed on the ionizing stellar clusters of this galaxy. And what's apparent is that they are not spatially coincident, that actually the blue colors are observed further to the southeast of the galaxy. They are not co-spatial with the ionizing stellar clusters. And this is now, I would say, confirmed through the analysis of equivalent width maps of SPSO35 with MUSE. This is the equivalent width map. You see that the equivalent width of H alpha rises outside of the ionizing stellar clusters to values of up to 1,800 angstrom. So the peak of the H alpha equivalent width is not coincident spatially with the peak of the ionizing stellar clusters. Gas is simply more extended, as we expect, than the ionizing stellar component. And we see this also in many other blue compact galaxies, this decoupling or spatial anti-correlation between stellar surface density and H alpha equivalent width. And coming to galactic scales, I would say the most extreme example is 1 sv18, where the galaxy itself, after subtraction of nebular emission, is just a faint area, comparable in size, by the way, as the nearby component C. The whole the LSP envelope of this galaxy is purely nebular. So basically, we see a situation where a compact star-forming galaxy is surrounded by an extended exponential halo, contrary to standard BCDs, where typically the H alpha emission is more compacted, confined to the inner part of the galaxy. In a young xBCD, we see this, that the nebular envelope is far more extended than the galaxy itself. And that's why we proposed with Jörn Slin that 1sv18 is a morphological prototype of high redshift, compact, high specific star formation rate galaxies. So compact galaxies experiencing a dominant phase in their formation history, surrounded by an exponential nebular halo. And in Pascal, I would like to mention that generally, starburst galaxies show an exponential nebular halo. Why this is the case, we do not know, but it is a generic property. This this halo can, of course, be misinterpreted as a disk, especially in high-redshift galaxies, in case that no additional spectroscopic data are present and one has only photometry. Now, the main point with the non-cospatiality between nebular and stellar emission is that in a galaxy, let me show this, in a galaxy like 1sv18, especially at higher redshifts, if we apply a population synthesis code, even a self-constant code, to the periphery of this galaxy, the gasmid periphery, then the code will assume that the ionizing photon budget responsible for the observed nebular emission is coming from the line of sight in situ. Will not have any handle to recognize that the observed nebular emission is of ex situ origin. And this could lead to a number of other biases. So what we need before applying spectral synthesis codes to spatially resolved data is to find additional tools and discriminators between in situ and ex situ gas excitation. Otherwise, systematic biases can be expected in studies of high redshift galaxies with, for instance, ELT, mosaic, and so on. I'm closing with a short summary. I hope that I could convince you a bit that xBCDs, very metal poor blue compact galaxies, local universe, are important laboratories to study the early stage of galaxy evolution in the epoch of reionization. I also showed that it is important to further explore the connection between gas phase metallicity, evolutionary status, and morphology. Especially cometary galaxies that are quite common at high redshifts should be studied in further detail. The effect of strong nebular emission is an important factor that has to be taken into account in spectral modeling. And in addition, the evolving non-cospatiality between stellar ionizing background and ionized gas in the complex 3D topology of a starburst galaxy is an important additional element that has to be considered when we are applying self-consistent spectral fitting tools on spatially resolved integral field spectroscopy data. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Polis. So I suppose there are maybe many questions. Sandrine, do you take over or shall I continue with the questions?
Yes, so people can raise their hand on the chat and you can give them the possibility to ask a question.
Gary has a question. Gary?
Yes, thank you, Polis, for this beautiful presentation. I learned a lot once again from you, like I learned previously in Lyon when we discussed at length about nebular emission, among other things. So I cannot resist one question, which is, have you actually done a SFADO analysis of the star formation histories of the xBCDs? Since SFADO handles correctly the nebular emission, so you should find younger ages, as you said, because the nebular emission being red fools you into believing that the ages are older. And if so, since with Marina and Tuan, we focused on galaxies that who had half their stellar mass formed in the last 1 billion years, what fraction of your xBCDs are such as very young as our threshold is? And my second question is, have you looked at the, maybe you said it, but I forgot. Have you looked for the xBCDs at the systematics of the gradients of age?
Gary, thanks for the question and for your interest in the field. I would say that the study of xBCDs with IFU data can only be done with 5-6 galaxies observed with MUs. These are Tololo 65 that Daniel knows very well. And there are also data of SPS 35 and Tololo 1214 minus 277. There are only 3-4 xBCDs only observed with MUs. And I'm processing with FADO these galaxies. I hope to have some results to show, discuss with you soon. But again, I would like to emphasize that a self-consistent spectral fitting code like FADO is a zero-dimensional, just like all the spectral synthesis tools, if we exclude perhaps moccasin. Yeah. So FADO assumes that the observed nebular emission is excited in situ by the line of sight, but cell population along the line of sight. And this is simply not correct. We have to take these results with caution and eventually develop further methods for disentangling between in situ and ex situ production of ionizing radiation when we apply FADO or other tools like Beagle to spatially resolve data. But I hope to have some results soon, okay, about this.
So I have a question to you regarding 1318 in particular. You showed very clearly the difference between this kind of object and normal BCDs. That reminds me that a long time ago, we used to make a plot between absolute magnitude, MB, for instance. It was even MPG at the very beginning. But between absolute magnitude and metallicity. So you know the relation. If you have very luminous galaxies, it tends to have a higher metallicity. But 1318 was far off the main relationship. How do you have an explanation for that? Because I never saw any convincing explanation. Do you think that the contribution of nebula luminosity would tend to shift enough 1318, so to join the general relationship?
That's a good question, Daniel. I don't know, to be honest, but if nebular emission, as we know, contributes about to half of the optical luminosity of 1318, this implies 0.75 Mach shift in the mass to in the luminosity versus metallicity relation. So almost one magnitude would be there.
I don't have in mind this relationship, but it was very far off. It was, to summarize, the 1318 was too much brighter for its low luminosity. It should have been very, very faint, like minus 13 or something like this, which is not what we...
Yes, this is a good point. And I think that a conceivable explanation is that this is due to nebular emission. If one corrects for the
please do it. So go back to that, and I can do it myself. But I am not sure that it's enough, even if you correct from this. I have another question now, which is more exotic. Suppose that you imagine that there must be, at some time, cosmic time, in some places, some truly genuine galaxy with no metallicity, zero metallicity. What do you think it would look like, and how would you try to find them?
Oh, this is a really exotic and exciting question that we can only discuss with Bordeaux wine in a restaurant in Paris, not a webinar. Well, a pristine galaxy, unpolluted by heavy metals, then do you think that there will be stars there? Will be a kind of stellar components formed previously?
Well, my question is where do metals come from? Do you need metals to start forming stars, or can you imagine that there is a place where stars form and ionize the nebula? And in other words, would you imagine that if you see a galaxy with only H alpha or no emission lines from metals, that would be, you would see, well, this is probably a zero metallicity galaxy? Or do you think that it's impossible, because as soon as you start forming stars, immediately you form metals and you will never find a zero metallicity galaxy? That's my question.
Yeah, well, it's a very good question, Daniel, to which I have no answer. I would say that metal-free galaxy, of course, having in mind the long cooling time scales of gas by Bremsstrahlung, will take long time to evolve to form any stars. But I don't know actually whether some seeds of metals in the early cosmos could be imparted in a proto-galaxy through ejecta of nearby proto-galaxies that have produced the first metals. And these traces of metals could be the coolants of gas leading them to star formation. Now, coming to metallicity, I think that one thing that we need to consider in all kind of metallicity studies is that the what we call metallicity is actually a luminosity weighted quantity, right? So we basically see the metallicity in the gas that is illuminated by young stars in the direct vicinity of star forming regions. And it's difficult to constrain the metallicity in the neutral phase around star forming regions. We know that it's very metal poor, right, from UV studies. Whether we can infer from the warm gas metallicity the metallicity or the total mass of metals in a galaxy, is it, in my opinion, unclear, or am I wrong?
I don't know.
you have found also with UV, I remember, that in 1318 the neutral phase is very metal poor, right? Mm-hmm. Much more metal poor than the warm phase.
Not so much. This has been a controversial issue. I think there is another question by Matt. Matt? Matthew? Yeah. We don't hear you. I think you have to activate the microphone. Matt?
Yeah, Matt is
Matt, speaking, we don't hear you. Sandrine, can you do something for Matt?
I don't think so.
Matt, hello.
Can you write down your question in the chat, Matt, maybe?
Yeah. Can you write it down? Well, is there another question from the audience? By the meantime?
Well, while Matt is trying to fix the macro, I would like to come back to the recently published work by Gary and about the spatial properties, the environmental properties of very metal poor galaxies. I think this is interesting that many of these xBCDs are forming in pairs or triplets. And one of those examples is actually 1318, and its counterpart, the C component here. Yeah, you see that in the with the contours in 1318, this is all what remains after subtraction of the nebular emission. And if we compare the main body of 1318 with the post-starburst C component, they are like Geminis. Yeah, they are almost indistinguishable in terms of their azimuthal extents and scale length. They're very similar. So these two galaxies apparently form together in a pair. And this is something that that is worth further exploring.
Okay, you anticipated one of my questions. I think you can hear me now.
Yes, Matt.
It was running through my headphones, that's why, which I didn't have the little dongle for my headphone. So I have two questions. So one is, do you know the mass function of BCDs?
You mean the mass, the distribution in present day stellar mass?
No, I really mean the density of sources in co-moving volume versus mass.
I do not have this on top of my head, but there have been determinations. I think also Gary has done some estimates, if I'm not wrong. I remember also work done by the Terlevich team on this question. But I do not remember now a reference, Matthew.
Well, good, you've given me some references because it's appropriate for some work I'm doing with Akeem and a student at High Redshift.
So if I can add, so what we did in a paper where I'm the lead author this year is that we calculated the fraction of galaxies that are quote unquote very young as a function of stellar mass. So then you can turn this around and work out the mass. You know, you can then multiply that fraction by the mass function and you'll get your mass function of very young galaxies. But then very young galaxies are not necessarily extremely metal poor, but there's a strong link.
Yeah, but in my case, I just care about what we would detect at high redshift, and it's just compact things that are bright enough. Okay. Because I remember your paper, Gary, and I don't remember seeing that. But my other question is about the propagating star formation. I'm curious as to what your opinion is, and why it seems to start at one end of the gas distribution and seems to propagate rather linearly. Because your possibilities are, it's sort of like a bar structure that you're seeing in some projection, or the other possibility is you're moving through a medium and that would naturally have it form on one side. The first one, I guess, would be a merger, and I'm kind of a big fan of mergers in these blue compact dwarfs. So what do you think about that?
Well, what I remember, Matt, is that we have discussed this question in Granada more than 10 years ago, and I still have no answer. Actually, it's not clear whether there is a unique single mechanism responsible for this kind of cometary morphologies. There are different hypotheses put forward. Let me again share the screen. There have been, of course, propagation is one hypothesis. Weak interactions have been proposed by Stone in 2006, or in the models by Bourneau, The idea is that violent disk stabilities and inward migration of star-forming clumps can lead, depending on projection on this, to this cometary or chain galaxies. And finally, there is the hypothesis, I think, first put forward by Elmer Green and then further explored by Sanz Almeida, that's of a stream-driven accretion of pristine of metal poor gas from the cosmic web colliding, reaching a disk galaxy at one edge and leading to a cometary morphology. I don't know whether there's a unique mechanism for this, but what I think that is important is the first question that you posed: what could be the triggering signal of this star formation propagation process? Let's assume that we have a static cold H1 cloud. At some point, star formation is ignited. Why does this happen? In the case of SPSO35, what I suspect is that the slightly older western component of this galaxy has experienced the previous starburst episode, then a kind of blast wave propagating to the east. Some time later ignited a starburst episode in the SPSE. Yeah, so that it is a kind of triggered star formation by a previous starburst event in nearby galaxy. But this does not solve your question, because the question the next is, what has triggered star formation in the western component?
Exactly, lopsidedness.
And then we can, of course, speculate about all kinds of things. For instance, let's suppose that we have relativistic particles ejected from a faraway AGN. How would be their interaction with an ambient cold gas or gamma rays or? So it is a very deep, actually, question.
Yeah, I mean, there is, in the local universe, there's 3079, which has a wind that runs into 3077, and it looks just like this. Oh, okay, thank you.
Okay, I have a question related to what you said. You said that in the local universe, we have about 78 extreme blue compact galaxies. Is that right? Did I understand clearly?
Yes, with a metallicity lower than 77.7, so it's a bit more relaxed.
Do we know more about these galaxies in terms of the presence of Wolf-Rayet stars? Because you know that the Wolf-Rayet stars are, I mean, they exist because the wind is driven particularly by dust. So if you have a very extreme galaxies in terms of metallicity, you would not expect to have so much Wolf-Rayet star signature. And it's already a surprise that in a galaxy like 1CK18, there are some Wolf-Rayet stars. So what about the general sample you speak about? Do you know, do you have any information? Is there any follow-up of this?
Actually, not to that extent. There have been studies by Yuri Zhotov and Tuan of this galaxy using, however, long-slit spectroscopy. So basically covering only part of the optical extent of these galaxies. To my best knowledge, there is no systematic study of the presence of Wolf-Rayet features, at least the blue bump, as a function of metallicity for all these galaxies. Only a few galaxies have been studied.
Okay. Can I say something?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So first of all, I take the opportunity to say hello to Polychronis. Yasu Polychroni. A long time we have not met.